CO2 diffusers are sexy. What am I saying? Anyways, you guys liked the short tutorial that we had a couple of weeks ago so much that we decided to do another one. This time we're going to talk about carbon dioxide reactors. Welcome to the beautiful world of aquascaping. CO2 reactors have a lot of pros and cons. There are two good things about them, actually. The first one is they're invisible. They usually sit inside the cabinet. The second biggest pro is that they do dissolve the CO2 gas completely. So you have a 100% dissolve rate. You don't lose any gas. The third pro is that you don't need to increase the pressure that is coming out of the bottle above, like, say, 1 bar. In contrary, with the diffusers, which need probably 2, 2.5, maybe 3 bars. So you need a lot of pressure to push the gas through these diffusers. You don't need that with these external reactors. And that makes this whole system a lot more manageable. Another pro is that when you start the CO2 in the morning, the levels, the CO2 levels will increase to the proper level much, much quicker. And you don't need to play around with placing the diffuser in the tank, finding the right spot for it, a spot where the flow would push the bubbles that rise up. All the gas does not come to the surface directly, so that there's time for it to dissolve into the water. You don't have that. You just have water and 100% CO2 gas dissolved in it. So let's see how this whole system looks like, right? Okay, we start with the bottle. I already did that. The bottle has a pressure reducer on. After the pressure reducer, ideally you would have a solenoid valve, and then you would have a check valve again. The same thing that we used in the previous carbon dioxide tutorial. So up until the check valve, everything is the same. After the check valve, we go into the reactor, and the gas has to enter the reactor from the top through this point. And as you can see, can you see it? There's a white plastic hose that leads all the way to the bottom of the reactor. When you start the gas, and I will just gently open it, you can see that the gas will come up. You don't need a bubble counter for the CO2 if you have a reactor. Take into consideration that this hose is much, much bigger than a normal bubble counter point would be. So you need a lot less gas. This amount of gas would probably be too much, even for 120p. So I will just close it a little. So this is the bubble rate that I would use. Okay, so do you see what's happening? It enters from the top, it goes to the bottom, and it comes out at the bottom. And the gas will probably try to go upwards, as with all gases, in the water. And then we have an external filter, not like this one, because this is not suitable for reactors. This is not strong enough. This is a great Oasa FiltroSmart small filter, suitable for small tanks. One disadvantage here for the external reactors is that you would need a much, much stronger filter in order to be able to operate them. Why? Because you need enough strength, enough flow to push the water through the reactor. So the water enters from the top, goes all the way to the bottom, exits at the bottom, and then comes out of the cabinet and goes into the tank. So what you need to do is to cut the outflow of the filter and make sure that you put in this external reactor like that. Okay? What else do you need for the external reactor before you start it? You need another hose, ideally longer than what I used here. And this one connects to this part here. You connect it to the one that does not have a white hose visible. So it's just a hole in it with a plug. So you plug it in, and then you have a tap on the other side. This serves to get rid of this gas here. What is this gas? This is air. When you prime this whole system, air gets into it, so you need to get rid of the air. And then you have this mounting thing. You mount this against the back wall of the cabinet, and then you push this on, and it stays on the back wall of the cabinet, near the filter like this. Okay, so you don't break the hose. So this is an ideal thing. What you have to know is that these guys are much easier to use with a pH controller. So if you have a pH controller, I've got a small one here from Ista. It comes with the probe. The probe has to be in the aquarium, so that's one thing that will be visible in the tank. You connect the probe to that part, you plug this in, and then you plug the solenoid valve onto this one. And then you set a pH level that you want to set here. You can have a pH 7 or pH 4. These guys work seamlessly, and then we have a complete tutorial about how these automatizations work, because Viktor was kind enough to do one for us. I'm going to link that in the description, and that tutorial will teach you how to use these pH controls together with this system, with the lighting system, etc. So that's quite an in-depth tutorial. Other than that, the disadvantages of these external reactors, quite a few. One of them, you cannot use them with small tanks, because you need a strong filter and you need a big tank for it. Why do you need a strong filter? Because the flow should be strong enough to be, you know, able to push the gas out of this reactor, which has to stand in vertical position. So don't try to mount this horizontally or just leave it hanging like this right here, because that wouldn't work. So you actually need to put it vertically. If you have a problem, the filter has clogged, then this whole system will be noisy. You can hear the water flowing inside the cabinet, and it's not a good thing. Another thing is that you break this hose, because ideally this hose exits the external filter, goes into the tank without any breakage. If you do have something in between, like a UV filter or an external reactor, you suddenly have a problem, because there's leakage, okay? If you have water, there's leakage. You can see that dripping right now. This is a problem. So it means that you need to fasten this screw, this plastic element, a lot more so that you don't have that problem over there. If you can, please place a hose clamp over there on the top and at the bottom at the hose joints. If you place a clamp there, everything will be cool. Oh, and additionally, if you have a pH controller, you will not need any digital timers. You will only need the digital timers if you don't have a pH controller. And you'll have to stop the CO2 together with the lights, as I explained to you in the previous tutorial, and you have to start 1 hour, 1.5 hours before the lights. So not as soon as you would with a regular diffuser, because as I told you, this is 100% dissolve rate, so you don't need as much time. And additionally, one very, very important thing, and this is why I love this, there are no bubbles visible, because the CO2 gas is dissolved completely, so there are no CO2 bubbles visible. If you would have like an internal reactor or a diffuser, you would see the CO2 bubbles, you would obstruct the view of the tank with the technology visible, so I don't like that. So there are many, many advantages of that. Me, I would just use these external reactors without a blink in big tanks. All right, with that said, I think we're done. We'll see you on Thursday. I hope that you liked this. Maybe we'll have another video explaining to you about further elements of the CO2 system. Let us know if you want any further videos. We'll see you on Thursday.